The story went that my great-grandmother cried so much and so loudly for 3 months that her family finally unbound her feet. Because her family were northern Chinese, Shandong people, and tall, my great-grandmother's feet had been bound at an especially young age, when she was about 3 years old. The big toe was left as is, and the four smaller toes crushed towards the pad of her foot, and then tight strips of cloth were tied around her foot, pushing the toes towards the heel. The point was to break the arch, and to prevent the foot from ever growing, so that it would remain the ideal size of a 3-inch golden lotus. Wealthy families had been binding their girls' feet since the Tang Dynasty in the 8th century AD, and my great-grandmother's family had had no intention of stopping. After all, who would marry a girl with big feet? Not a man from a wealthy family, only a poor man who needed a wife to work in his fields. But my great-grandmother cried so ferociously that her family began to seek new solutions. This was the late 19th century, and people's ideas were beginning to change. American missionaries had come to Shandong. They brought Western medicine and established hospitals and coeducational schools. When they came to my great-grandmother's family's compound, her family was not particularly interested in their tales of heaven and hell, but they listened when the missionaries said they could help the youngest daughter. They promised to educate her in the Western style, which was considered modern and daring, and they promised that she would be able to find a husband when she grew up, a man who would not care whether a girl's feet were large or small, because he too would have been educated in this new manner. So my great-grandmother's family decided to take this risk. They unbound her feet and let the missionaries educate her in this new American way, and when she was old enough, she married a Chinese man educated in this new style as well. And when my grandmother was born, no one tried to bind her feet. She was educated alongside her brothers, and she became one of the first 8 women in China admitted into a public university in 1920. I know this story because my great-grandmother told her daughter, my grandmother, who told my mother, her daughter-in-law, who told me. However, I don't even know my great-grandmother's name. The only records we still have list her simply as Ms. Shao. When I saw Laura Puri's ceramic slippers with their long trailing cords and painfully pointed toes, I immediately thought of my great-grandmother's story. Historians now think that foot binding began in the Tang Dynasty in imitation of the toe shoes that an emperor's favorite concubine wore. She was a dancer, but this detail was forgotten. All the girls whose feet were molded and broken to fit into her fetishized shoes would never dance a day in their lives.